In November 2020, deep in the coast mountains of British Columbia, Canada, rock weighing the equivalent of all 25 million cars in Canada fell off the side of a mountain and came crashing down onto a glacial lake far below. It caused a tsunami-like wave that tore down a valley, bringing trees with it, completely devastating the creek and river that once trickled from the mountain. Finally, as the floodwaters met the sea, they formed an underwater avalanche that traveled far out into the surrounding fjord, reshaping the seabed below. What started as a landslide high up in the mountains left a mark on the ocean far downstream. Can the landscape recover from such a catastrophic event? And can we expect more of these dangerous cascades in the future? Here in the coast mountains, the slopes are constantly moving, often slowly, but sometimes all at once. In fact, dozens of landslides occur every year, many of which happen so far from where people live that they go unnoticed by us. But they do get noticed by the animals in these landscapes, who are constantly adapting to the shifting environment. And once in a lifetime, you might get a hazards cascade, an event so massive it wreaks havoc on an ecosystem. And that's just what happened with the Elliott Creek landslide in 2020.
So you can think of it like a set of dominoes. So we had one event that triggered another event, that triggered another event, that triggered another event. And the end result of that is a set of processes that traveled much, much farther than just a landslide would have.
The amount of logs that were pulverized was quite amazing. Where there used to be trees and there's nothing there now, just but gravel, that looks quite devastating. All the spawning beds for salmon, they got smothered. And so I think we're looking at some other devastation to the salmon stocks in this area.
The fear researchers have is that as climate change advances, we might see more of these cataclysmic events happen around the world. Because as glaciers melt and recede, they destabilize the bedrock around them, creating an environment ripe for landslides. And the shrinking glaciers often leave giant lakes below them that are a high risk for flooding events like at Elliott Creek. And the next time, people might get caught up in the cascade. Given the high stakes, we need to better understand hazard cascades, what causes them, and how often they happen. Fortunately, the area where the Elliott Creek Hazards Cascade occurred just happens to be one of the best studied inlets in the world.
This seems to be the first major dramatic flow event that's happened anywhere that's actually been recorded. And so it's literally the first opportunity as scientists we've been able to see one of these things in person and what its effects are and how it recovers.
By a stroke of luck, the Hakai Institute had already mapped the area before the landslide occurred, thanks to partners Terra Remote Sensing and Hakai's Airborne Coastal Observatory, a plane with a payload of cameras and LIDAR scanners. LIDAR stands for Light Detection and Ranging. The LIDAR maps show geomorphologists what the landscape looked like before the slide, so they can remap the area again to get an estimate for how much rock and debris shifted downstream. But that map only covers the land. A team of researchers are here today to map where the slide continued underwater. Fortunately, the underwater landscape had also been mapped in detail before the slide by a team led by UK University researchers, as well as the Canadian Geological Survey, the Canadian Hydrographic Service, the Coast Guard, the Hakai Institute, and the University of Calgary. So we have a baseline to compare with the underwater landscape after the slide.
So a turbidity current, picture a big billowy dense flow on the seafloor that looks kind of like a snowy avalanche, but it's actually seawater and sand and mud, carves a channel in the seafloor, and with subsequent events carves the channel deeper and deeper. But as it's doing this, it's redistributing sediment throughout the channel.
Dan Sugar is part of the team that is here in Butte Inlet to measure the underwater aftermath of the event.
But what we're here doing right now is to try to map the seafloor in very high resolution to look at how that seafloor has changed and how it was impacted by that incredibly powerful flow coming on, ripping out parts of the seafloor.
mapping the seafloor requires different tools than mapping the land. Where LIDAR maps terrain with lasers using light energy, this Hakai research vessel and the federal research ships used by the team are equipped with a multi-beam echo sounder, which uses sound energy to map the seabed. Pulses of sound are emitted from the boat, and the amount of time it takes for each pulse to bounce off the seabed and return to the boat is converted to a distance.
It's very similar to a depth sounder that you'd find on most vessels. But instead, rather than just having a single beam firing from that sonar, it's got a number of them, 512 to be exact. And so because of that, we're able to generate these exceedingly dense point clouds, and which eventually turn into digital surface models.
Nick is operating the multi-beam from a shallow-bottomed boat to map the edges of the inlet, while the Canadian Coast Guard science ship maps the greater depths. By comparing the pre- and post-slide data, researchers can see the erosion in red and all the sediment in blue that was dumped into the ocean. All of this work helps the researchers understand the effect of the cascade on the landscape. But they also want to figure out how and when hazard cascades could happen again. To do that, they need to look even further back in time. So they deploy a long corer into the seabed to pull up layers of sand and mud that go back centuries. These are scanned and dated in a lab at the Geological Survey of Canada. The layers each represent a different chapter in the geological history of this place, and can tell them if something of this magnitude has happened before.
We had been in Butte Inlet before, and we've seen these layers, and we dated them to about every 150 years, and we don't really know what they are. And so when this occurred, we thought maybe this is one of the events causing these layers. Something like that occurs very rarely, like sort of once in a career for sure.
And from what they've seen so far, the Elliott Creek slide truly was an extraordinary flow event, with nothing in the previous monitoring years having disturbed the seabed nearly as much. But what exactly is the lasting impact of the Elliott Creek slide on the inlet? After all, a large forest was essentially washed into it. How effective will the fjord capture and bury all that organic material? And what of the river that was completely rerouted?
It's a little hard to say whether the landscape here has been changed forever. And I think part of that depends on your perspective. And so, you know, landscapes are always trying to get back to some sense of equilibrium. And so I suspect that, you know, eventually the rivers will come back to sort of, you know, what they were, so to speak. And the same thing on the seafloor. And one of the things that we're really interested in, at least in the marine work here, is trying to understand how quickly that might happen.
This is the fourth survey of the year, and the data is pouring in, showing how the inlet changed as a result of the outburst flood and how it's changed in the months since. Just 2 years after the event, the seabed in the main sediment pathway has begun to flow the same as it did before. But like aftershocks, the snowmelt of each passing spring is likely to continue to bring remaining landslide material with it into the inlet. That's one of many things the team will be keeping an eye on. It's incredibly rare and fortunate that Butte Inlet has been so well studied over the past decade, since it allows us an unprecedented opportunity to understand how such a big event has reshaped the landscape and how it fits into the area's geological history. Even more importantly, researchers hope that someday soon, the data gathered here will also shed light on future hazard cascade risks on the BC coast. It's incredible what we could learn by digging into the mud and sand of this bare earth to finally see that bigger picture.